We'll conclude this section with a theorem, which is you can think of as a generalization of the Lax-Milgram lemma. Let me recall the Lax-Milgram lemma. So H is a Hilbert space, and then A from H cross H to R. I'm taking a real Hilbert space this time. Okay, so that doesn't matter, bilinear form, it is continuous, that means mod of AUV is less than or equal to M times norm U norm V, and H elliptic, that means AUU is greater or equal to alpha times norm U square. So this is for all UV in H, for all U in H. So there exists M positive and there exists alpha positive. Okay. And F is given in H, then Lax-Milgram says there exists a unique U in H such that AUV equals FV for every V in H. And then we also saw in the exercises you could do it for subspaces. We found, and then we even proved this in two different ways. One is via for a separable Hilbert space and so on. So I recall, I hope you remember all those things. Now the ellipticity condition is always a strong one, and you may not, it's difficult to have it. So here is one which relaxes it under some conditions. Okay, so proposition. Let V and H be Hilbert spaces such that V is continuously embedded in H with dense inclusion. That means V is a subset of H, subspace of H. It, but the inclusion, the norm here, the inclusion map is continuous with respect to the respective norms, and then the V is a dense subspace of H in the H topology. Okay, let A from V cross V be a bilinear, be a continuous bilinear form, such that AUU equal to 0 implies U equal to 0. So this is all the condition. So this is much weaker than the ellipticity condition is here. Assume further that there exists alpha greater than 0 and beta greater than 0 such that for every U in V, we have V in V, AVV is greater than or equal to alpha times norm V square, the norm in V, minus beta times norm V square in H. Okay, so there is a negative things now, so this is not elliptic at all, there is something minus here, but this inequality is good enough. Let F belong to H be given, then there exists a unique U in V such that AUV equals FV for every V in V. Okay, so this is the same conclusion as the Lax-Milgram theorem, but you now have, you don't have ellipticity, instead you have a compromise. You have a dense inclusion in under Hilbert space where you, and you have an inequality of this form, and you also have that AUU equal to 0 implies U equal to 0. Okay, so proof. So consider the bilinear form A, capital A, from V cross V into R, given by A of VW equals AVW plus beta times VW, and this inner product is taken in H. Okay, so this FV inner product obviously is in H because F is given in H. Okay, then A is continuous, there's no problem there. A is continuous because mod AUV, AVW is less or equal to norm M times norm V in V, norm W in V, plus beta times norm V in H, norm W in H, but that's less or equal to M times norm V, norm W in V, plus C times C square times beta, because norm in H is less than C times norm in V, okay, norm V in V, norm W in V, okay, because you have that norm V in H is less than or equal to C times norm V in V for every V in V. This is the V is continuously embedded in H. That is the reason we have this. Okay, so it is clearly continuous. What about AVV? Let's see, greater than or equal to alpha times norm V square in V. Okay, and also the map V going to F of V is also continuous because mod FV is less than equal to norm F, this in H, norm F in H, norm V in H, that's less than equal to C times norm F in H, norm V in H. Therefore, by the Riesz representation theorem, you can write this as some RF. So, FV in H can be written as some RF Riesz map times V in V, and therefore, it is you can apply Lax-Milgram lemma. Okay, so there exists a unique U in V such that AUV equals FV in H. So, we will apply it with RF, and RFV is same as FV, and therefore you have this AUV equals FV. Okay, so I am going to call U equals definition G of F. So, alpha times norm V square in V is less than or equal to AVV equals FV, which is less than or equal to C times norm F in H. So, this is in H, and norm V in V cancel 1. So, therefore, you get that norm U square, sorry, is AUU FU FU. So, norm U in V is less than or equal to C by alpha times norm F in H. Therefore, this mapping G, which takes H to V, is continuous. So, I forgot one important hypothesis. So, assume further that this inclusion is compact. So, the dense inclusion is dense and compact. So, it is a linear operator between Hilbert spaces, the inclusion map, and that map is compact. Okay. So, that's why this theorem comes in this chapter. So, okay. So, we can now compose. So, H to V, you have a mapping G, and V is included in H, and this is compact. So, this implies that G from H to H is compact. So now assume U is a solution of star. What is star? That is the equation which you wanted to study. Okay. Then for every V in V, you have A of UV plus beta times UV in H equals F plus beta U times V. And conversely, if U solves this, then beta UV gets cancelled and therefore A UV equals FV. So solving the original problem star is the same as solving the problem double star. Okay. Now if you look at this, this can be written, that is U is the solution for this given the right hand side F plus beta U. So U equal to G of F plus. So let us write F plus beta U equal to Z. So U equal to GZ. Therefore F equal to Z minus beta U, which is Z minus beta GZ. So U solves star if and only if Z minus beta GZ equal to F, where Z equals F plus beta U. Okay, so that is the, so we want to know if you can solve this. So once you find the Z, then you can say Z minus F divided by beta, beta is positive, that will give you U, which is the solution of the original equation. So it is enough to solve this equation where G now is a compact operator from H to H. So I minus beta G is a compact perturbation of identity in H. So if you want it to solve for any F, so that means it is onto if and only if it is 1 to 1. So it is enough to check. So this is the beauty of this theory. So if you want to solve an equation, you just say this, if at all the solution exists, then it is unique. So the uniqueness implies the existence. So that is the nice thing about these results. In finite dimensions, that's always true. And now we are having it in this case. So you prove uniqueness, that is a much easier thing, and that implies automatically that there exists a solution for any data. Okay. So assume I minus beta G of W equal to 0. Okay. Now this means what? W equals beta G W. Now where does G live? G, remember, is from H to V and then it's included in H. So this belongs to V. The solution, the range is always contained in V. And therefore you get that AWV plus beta WV equals, so double star implies, okay, this is for every V in V, okay, equals W equals beta GW. So we have, that means you are solving with the right hand side beta W. So beta W times V. Okay, it's not this is the definition of G. Okay. Okay, G is a linear map. So if you have right hand side beta W, then the solution of the corresponding equation with that is going to be equal to this, and all these inner products are in H. But then these two cancel out, so this implies that A of WV equal to 0 for every V in V. W is also in V. This implies A of WW equal to 0, and by hypothesis this means that W equal to 0. Therefore I minus beta G is 1 to 1, implies on 2, implies there exists solution to double star and hence to star. Now uniqueness is obvious, because if you have two solutions, A of U1V equals FV and A of U2V equals FV, then A of U1 minus U2V equal to 0 for all V, and this implies that A of U1 minus U2, U1 minus U2 equal to 0, and therefore this implies that U1 has to be equal to U2. So you have a unique solution. Now this the Lax-Milgram lemma is very useful, as I said, in studying the existence of weak solutions to elliptic partial differential equations, and so also this one. So the different kinds of boundary conditions will lead to problems which can be either posed as in the Lax-Milgram framework or in this framework, and therefore both these results are very useful in the study of PDEs. Okay.